I am thrilled to get to stand here again. I had the chance to go away with some friends that I share life with here that are kind of spurring me on to loving good deeds. A bunch of 50th birthdays kind of collapsed together, and so we went away for a little bit and just enjoyed each other and had great conversation and enjoyed a few days away. But I will tell you, even better than getting to do that is having the privilege of looking forward to coming back. Not just to see your family, that's obvious. But when you love what you do and who you do it with and where you get to do it, man, life is sweet. And I want to express my thanks to you all, I really do. Because a huge part of why I look forward to coming back, having been gone away for a number of days, was because of this community right here. The friends that are here, the way you spur me on, the way you serve each other. When I came last Sunday, I got in about midnight and it was about a 7-hour time change. And so it was already 7 in the morning for me when I got there, and later in the day, obviously, when we gathered in the morning, I couldn't wait to get here. And folks, the way y'all greeted me in the parking lot, that team, the way the folks greeted me as I came in, the way that I knew that the worship team had been here since early in the morning, having been here late Thursday night getting ready, and then folks bring them breakfast every Sunday morning. Folks were there when I had a chance to drop my kids off, which I don't do normally, and love them and were excited to see them and me. And I just thought, man, I live in a really, really blessed place because I'm a part of this family. And those of you that are a core part of this family, that make this thing go, by realizing we are a battleship, we each take our stations underneath a higher captain, and that aren't here on a cruise ship, that aren't here on scholarship, but that are investing with their stewardship of life and resources to make this happen, I want to tell you, you make my life sweet. And I just want to thank you for how great it was to come back home after just, 5-7 days to be here. I really did miss y'all, so it's great to be here. Thank you. I love what I get to do here. I love that I get to serve in this role. And what I want to talk about today, I told you, I've never done this before on Mother's Day. I've never done a mama message on Mother's Day. I'm not going to just talk about mom. I'm going to talk about women specifically. I'm going to talk about women and their role in the church. I'm going to explain to you why women will never teach here or ever be elders at Watermark. Now, you kind of think, well, go for it, big guy. And, I probably should have done this before I left the country, for 7 days. But I want to share with you, I want to tell you how that ties into mom. And I think you'll be encouraged. I think you will. So let's dive in. But why don't we pray first? Lord, I thank you that we get to stand here and learn from you. We don't get to share our ideas. We do not impress upon heaven our agenda. We seek to have our heart available to yours, even when we pray, as we'll discuss in a minute. It's about aligning us with you, not about getting you moving where we want you to go. And so even in the area of leadership and expression of giftedness, we don't want our culture to shove us. We want your word to direct us. And in the midst of that, Lord, may there be serenity and peace and joy and glory in the land. I pray you'd use this morning toward that end. And I thank you for the way you use this body to bless my family, the community of which I'm a part, and increasingly the world in ways that we all marvel at. We thank you, Lord, for the goodness of your word. May it own us. Amen. Well, let me start by saying this. When we talk about women and their roles, I never want to say, and did not say, that women are disqualified from teaching men or disqualified from eldership. I don't like that because of what it implies. Disqualification would seem to indicate a lack of quality which keeps you from being able. Let us begin by noting clearly that there is nothing about women that disqualifies them in their nobility, in their value, in their dignity, in their honor, in their position before Christ, that would ever keep them from doing anything. But there is clarity in God's decree and in God's created order. God is a gracious God, and he wants things to work well for his people. We had as Gary mentioned, a little leadership time together on Friday where hundreds from the community came, and we're here, we had a little lunch, and we had leadership lessons for troubled times. And one of the things we talked about on this panel was the need for leadership to lead. But how leadership leads is very important. One of the gentlemen that was on the panel is a part of our community, leads a corporation with over eight figures in assets, in the billions, over 1,000 employees. And one of the observations he made is we have struggled lately because there has not been a clear leader amongst the three of us that are in front of this company. And so there's a lot of awkwardness in the way we are running the organization. And you add that on top of the crisis and trouble that's in our general economic times today, and it's led to a change in the number of figures in their assets. And he was talking about how important it is to have clear leadership. We see this everywhere. Where there is no clear leadership, there is chaos. God did not leave a horse race out there to see who could get to certain positions first, and that we would politic and claw and fight over it. There was no, as one man said, jump ball. He said, this is the way it's going to work. There's a quarterback in this huddle, and the quarterback has got to lead in a way that allows that team to move the ball down the field and score. When you get a wide receiver in the huddle, when you get T.O. telling Tony, this offense goes through me, hush yourself. I don't care who gets the ball first. I'll tell you where it goes next. You've got chaos on the team. There has to be leadership. But note this. The kind of leadership that is there matters immensely. Immensely. And I want to just start by acknowledging that if I was a woman, I wouldn't be happy. Not because I was a woman, but because of men and the fact that they are not leading and have not led well. When you ask the question, why should women not teach and why should women not lead? If you in any way go to dignity, honor, or ability, you are stepping outside the revelation of God's word. But it's because of a specific decree of God who chooses to reveal truth in a way that will help us. The reason women don't teach is not because men are brilliant. The reason women don't lead is not because men have always led well. Take a flashback in history, and whatever you think, you won't come away with, you know, I'm really glad guys got behind the wheel. We'll see all kinds of horrors. We'll see all kinds of mistakes because men in their brilliance have led horribly. And if I was a woman, I'd be the first one to take my bra off, declare myself a feminist, get a pitchfork, and storm the castle. If I didn't know Christ. Now, welcome to Watermark. Happy Mother's Day. Turn to 1 Timothy 2, and I'm going to show you why. We're going to start in verse 8. It says in verse 8, and I'm going to go back and show you some stuff earlier in 1 Timothy chapter 2, but verse 8, it begins by saying, therefore, and so that therefore is there for a reason. You always ask, why is that there for? And it's explained earlier, but watch this. Therefore, I want men in every place to pray. In other words, boys, make sure you're on your knees getting your directive from heaven. You don't give heaven direction, you take it from heaven. I want men in every place lifting up holy hands. Don't offer prayers to me if your life is not concerned with me. God does not like men who take religious activity and do it well. He wants men whose hearts have been consumed and constrained by the love of God. So when you pray, he says, make sure you pray without wrath and dissension, without anger and dissolution of relationships defining who you are. In fact, God says, if you go to pray and you find out that you've got a conflict with your brother, then quit your praying and go deal with that conflict with your brother. Because the very first thing I'm going to tell you in this little communique we're about to have is love one another. Be merciful, even as you've received mercy. Forgive, even as you've been forgiven. Love the way that I have loved you. And so if you've got dissension around you, quit your praying and go act prayerfully. If you are an angry leader, men, you're not leading well. He says this as a final credo to men before he starts talking about women. Now watch this, verse 9. Likewise, meaning gals, this is how I want you to hang out. I want you to adorn yourself with proper clothing, modestly and discreetly. It's fixing to get warm, ladies. Note 1 Tim 2:9. Modestly and discreetly. We need gals at this church that will shepherd one another and love one another with this information. At my house, I take care of the women at my house. They ask me, hey, what do you think about this? When my little girls are getting dressed, they don't ask mom if this is okay. She goes, go ask the one that God created to be visually stimulated. He'll tell you. And so I take care of my little girls, and I help my wife, and I say, that is not modest or discreet. I will tell you what that evokes in men. When that little V points down like that, my eyes follow that V. And that suggests to me that you want me to look at that. And that suggests to me that you're advertising that. Do you want to be a kind of woman that advertises that way? Girls, I want to say this. This is not my message right now about that. But if you want to get a guy because of your physical presentation, you will be able to get men through your physical presentation. But note to self, the same men that you get through physical presentation, you will lose through physical presentation. And everything we do, we are to do for the purpose of honoring God and helping one another. And if you are dressing to exalt self without being mindful of others, guy or gal, male or female, you're dressing incorrectly. If you love Jesus, that's his exhortation to you. I want women to adorn themselves, he says, properly, modestly and discreetly, not with braided hair, gold or pearls or costly garments, but rather by means of good works, as is proper for women making a claim to godliness. This is key. Note who we're talking to. Some of you guys are here and go, I don't buy any of this stuff. And I go, well, maybe you haven't bought the idea of who Jesus is yet, and that's okay. We're glad you're here. We'd love to talk to you about that idea. But if you make a claim to godliness, then you ought to adorn yourself in that which is godly, that which is good. And he says, those things are not external. They're internal. And he goes on then to say this, verse 11, a woman must quietly receive instruction with entire submissiveness. If I haven't lost you, ladies, I know that a few of you just went, that's about enough today, all right? But hang in there, it gets worse. Look it. Verse 12, I do not allow a woman to teach or exercise authority over a man, but to remain quiet. You kind of look at that and you go, wow, look, it's amazing to me the way the church has caved to societal pressures, to liberal hermeneutic, to pragmatism. And they have gotten so creative in the way that we interpret a verse. See, there's not a lot of verse there to jack around with. It's pretty clear what God wanted us to take note of, that women are not to teach or exercise authority over a man. A woman teach, a woman evangelize, a woman lead, a woman be missional. Fantastic, no problem. But in the huddle, there's a quarterback. Let that quarterback. You are a wide receiver. You run your routes, you score, and that quarterback cannot be successful without you, but you're not the quarterback. And so in the huddle, quiet. Now, I'm going to explain quiet to you. Here's how you typically handle words like this. When you see that word quiet, you go, is there another place that that word quiet is used? Because quiet can mean a lot of things, even in the English language. Quiet can imply don't speak, or quiet can express a condition of an environment. And so what is going on right here in this word quiet? The best way to understand how an author is using that word is to see if that word is used other places by that author. And so, luckily, this word is used only one other time in your Bible. And guess where it is? Not just 10 verses earlier. So, let's scan up now, and let's look at the beginning of 1 Timothy chapter 2, and let's figure out what is going on here. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1, he says, first of all, then, I urge that entreaties and prayers, petitions, and thanksgiving be made on behalf of all men, for kings and all who are in authority, so that we may lead a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. Meaning, in a democratic republic that we're in, you do your homework, you study your elected, your candidates that could be elected, and then you vote for those men and women that will serve effectively But once they're there, you pray that they would lead in such a way that we would not have to be moved towards civil disobedience, because we serve a higher authority even than our government. We do all we can to honor our governing authorities, but when our governing authorities assert themselves over us and say, do this, and God says, don't do that, we are moved to civil disobedience. And he says, you pray for these men that they would make laws and define order in a way that's consistent with how God says you should live, so that you can live a quiet life. In other words, you don't have to take your bra off, grab a pitchfork, and storm the castle. Pray for them. There are times that we've just got to speak up, and we've just got to say, we're having a tea party. And I mean, a major one, because of the oppressiveness, because of the injustice, because of the wrong that you are imposing upon us or imposing upon others, whatever it might be. And he says, you pray for those that are in authority over you, that they would be in authority over you in such a way that you would not have to take them on. This is one of the reasons Christians were hated in first century Rome, is because they said, look, we want Caesar to be successful, but when Caesar wants us to worship him, I can't go there. And so I'm going to pray for Caesar. I pray Caesar is successful. I pray Obama is a well thought of, respected, generous, successful administrator of our government. But if he chooses to ask me to live in a way that is dishonoring to God, I got to say, I can't do that, sir, and be ready to bear the consequences of that. And that won't be tranquil or very quiet for any of us. What the scripture is saying here is not pray that you've got a good government so you don't ever speak. So look back down now at 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 12. It's not saying, women, don't ever speak in church. What it's saying is, look, let the men lead. And don't try and take the mantle from them. They're there to lead, and they're the quarterback, and let it go. Now, what do you do if the man does not lead well? And I want you to note where this conversation is being had. It is being had in the context of a community of people that are redeemed. The call is that women cannot teach or exercise authority over men in the community of the redeemed. Because in the community of the redeemed, the men lead in a way that women go, great, I'm cool with that. Because that guy in control loves me, cares for me. His leadership is not about exalting himself. His leadership is about exalting me. The women at this church should never care if they have to prepare to teach on Sunday before men and women. They should never care if they have to be an elder and make decisions about certain things. Because I'm saying, I want to tell you what the elders do. The elders love women. They care about women. They exalt women. They free us up from distractions so that we can do what God called us to do. And they don't do anything which is not with our best interests in mind. Women don't have a hard time. Men don't have a hard time with selfless leaders overseeing them. We made the note in the leadership lessons for troubled times that one of the effective rules of leadership is you need to talk to folks that your leadership impacts. How's this going to affect you? What resources do you need to be successful in your job? How can I fight a fight for you? How can I protect you from distractions? What can I do to make you successful? You want that kind of boss who says, I want you to have the best year you've ever had. I want you to enjoy your environment more than you've ever enjoyed this environment. I don't want to have a bunch of red tape. I don't want to have a bunch of bureaucracy. I don't want to have a bunch of meaningless rules that make me somehow feel powerful and burden you. I want you to succeed. My job as a boss is to make you successful. I like that kind of boss. I like that kind of God. And that's exactly what God says to me. That's what Jesus said when he was here. I didn't come to be served, but to serve. Paul, the same guy who wrote this, says, when you lead, do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, consider one another as more important than yourself. Don't really look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. You know what women say to that kind of guy? Here's my number. Lead me. Because all you want to do is look out for me. Girls go to bed dreaming about that kind of leadership. Every great movie ever made is about a girl meeting that kind of guy. And God says, that's what I want. Now watch this, man. What I want to do just for a second, and ladies, feel free to listen in, but I want to have a chat with the guys. And what I want to talk to you guys about is I get so sick of hearing guys go, my wife doesn't respect me. She doesn't lead me. I know God's word. God's word says specifically she'd be subject to me, and she isn't subject. And I'm going to go, okay, come here, clueless. Let me explain to you why she's not subject to you. And I don't have the verses for you here, but in Ephesians chapter 5, starting in verse, I think 20, it says there this. It says, be subject to one another in love. It talks about a spirit-filled person, somebody who's not deluded or drunk with wine, but somebody who's being filled with the Spirit of God. It says, you two, male and female, be subject to one another in love. And then it says this. It says, wives, be subject to your husbands as to the Lord. And guys love that verse, man. They love Ephesians 5, verse 22. Because it says, for the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ also is the head of the church, he himself being the savior of the body. But the church is subject to Christ, and the wives ought to be subject to their husbands in everything. Now, right after that, it says, boys, you listen in. You love your wives just as Christ loved the church. So why do I do all this? Because men, listen to me. When you've got a problem with people following you, the problem is often not with the people following you. It is with your leadership, because people love benevolent dictators. They love quarterbacks that aren't looking to get on the cover themselves, but to make you an all-pro receiver, who all they want to do is genuinely exalt you and maximize your giftedness. They love that kind of leadership. Now, here's what we've got. What I did a long time ago is I sat down with Ephesians chapter 5, and I wrote down the job description of a man and the job description of a woman in the context of marriage, just like Ephesians chapter 5 explains it. Well, I'm just show you both these job descriptions, and I want women for you to see what we're up against and how hard it is for us, and I genuinely mean that. Now, watch this. This is the job description of a husband. If we're going to love you like Christ loved the church, we must love you unconditionally, constantly, completely, sacrificially, selflessly, even to the point of death. We're to do that eternally. We are to initiate with you when you are not somebody that is attractive to us. We're to do that with great patience and to never get worn out and go, that's enough. 3 months, 6 months, 6 years is enough. I'm pulling back. We're to be tender. We're to be unshakable, and the adjective which describes how we do all those things is perfectly. Now, you, on the other hand, here's your job description. You are to respond to the husband, be subject to the husband, even as the church is subject to Christ. You're to respond in love, celebrating, being respectful, obedient, submissive, humble. You adore them. You fully invest in that relationship. You are devoted. You celebrate. Now, look, which one of those two is harder? To do what Christ did, just like Christ did it perfectly, or to respond to it? Now, here's what happened. As I was doing this one day, God said, hey, big boy, come over here. Let's take a look at this again, because you show up, Mr. Wagner, on both sides of this conversation. Over here, you are the male, but also in this church responding to Christ thing, you're the female. So let's take a look at that female thing again. And how are you doing at responding to me, Todd? Because that's you. You're the church. You're a follower of God. You love Jesus. Are you responding to him fully? Are you respecting Jesus fully? Are you obedient to him? Are you submissive at all times to Christ? Are you humble? Are you consumed, fully devoted to him? Do you adore him? Do you celebrate him? Or do sometimes you storm the castle and say, I think I'll be king. Stand down, God. This is about me right now. And I kind of went, well, there's a few moments that I sometimes don't. Yeah, I'm working hard to try and improve how I'm doing over there. And then God said to me this. He said, okay, big boy, imagine if that was your job description and your bridegroom wasn't perfect. Because Todd, you're responding to a perfect husband. You're responding to somebody who does love you unconditionally, constantly, completely, sacrificially, selflessly, even to the point of death, eternally, who initiates with you always with great patience, always tender towards you. He's unshakable, and he never misses. That's me. And you don't respond to me very well. How'd you like to do it if I was moody and inconsistent and self-exalting and oppressive? And I would say, well, that wouldn't be real fun. He goes, see what's also going on in your family right now. You know why she's not responding to you? Because even with perfect leadership, people have a hard time responding. See you to me. Can you imagine if they were called to respond to somebody like you? And you know what I always do whenever I get to this point? I go back and I humble myself and I say, oh, will you forgive me? I have been an awful quarterback. We had a moment like this at our house Friday night, where my wife just basically was, she grabbed the pitchfork, didn't take her bra off, but she did storm the castle. And I say, if you're going to do it, you got to do the whole thing. But my kids are getting older and they're in church now. So they sit over there and these things get more awkward all the time. But bottom line, my wife just said, I'm not going to be led like this. And you can't lead like this. And I go, I can't lead like this. You want to throw down? Bring your pitchfork. Because I got a catapult. And it just all of a sudden she kind of looked at me like, ugh. And walked out. And I, you know, took my own little walk and did my own little thing, came back, had a little of this conversation in my head, and just went, hey, I get why there was chatter in the huddle. You know? And I wouldn't want to follow that either. There was wrath and dissension and not humble leadership. And I make it so hard for you to be who God wants you to be. Now, I know that's still her job to be that, but by the way, here's what you do when the quarterback isn't listening. You say, hey, that's not the route we're supposed to run here. Hey, you do what I tell you to do. We're throwing the ball that way. That's not the way we're going to. Hey, shut up. I'm the quarterback. Okay, hang on. Time out. And you walk over and you just say, coach, I just want to let you know, man, he's the quarterback and I'll do what he says, but he's got me running this route and I don't think he's the quarterback you want. And I want to help him. I believe he's our quarterback. But you widen the circle. That's what you're supposed to do. Listen, ladies, if you love us, you don't look forward to embarrassing us, but what you say to us is, hey, I believe you that you want to be God's man in this marriage. I believe you want to love me. Maybe you don't know how, or maybe you're just right now so wrapped up in some emotional stuff that you can't be. I'm going to give you some distance, but I'm going to tell you, if you don't own that this is not good leadership, I'm going to love you enough to widen the circle, not to shame you, but to go to people that we both acknowledge would spur you on to love and good deeds, and they're going to tell me that I've got a great quarterback, or they're going to help you be the quarterback that I want you to be, because you're my quarterback, you're my man, and I do love you, and I am committed to you fully. And because I respect you, I won't let you act in a disrespectful way to yourself or your God. That's what a completing, loving wife does. That's where community comes in. And that community gets wider and wider until the whole church stands behind you and just says, hey, bro, we love you, but, you know, give us the ball because you're not going to lead right now. If that guy says, well, she ain't following me, I'm going to go, hey, what are you, a man of disobedience, doing appealing to a book of obedience? Because speed of the leader, speed of the team. I've got a buddy who's a part of this church whose mom, when he was little, used to grab him by the ear when he would mess up and would walk in to the bathroom with him and just say, you ask yourself this question, mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the cause of all my problems? And then make him turn and look right in that mirror. He was 20. He was away at school on a football scholarship, lost it due to academic prowess. And instead of coming home, complaining about the coach not being good to him and the tutors not helping him enough, his mom, when he was 20, grabbed him by the ear and took him in and said, stand there and look at that wall. Say these words, mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the cause of all my problems? She goes, say it! He goes, mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the cause of all my problems? She goes, right there's your problem, not your coach, not your tutor. You know what I want to do? Hey, guys, before you come and tell me your wife won't submit, walk into your bathroom. Look at the wall and say, mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the cause of all my marital problems? And then deal with it. Ask your wife's forgiveness. Start to lead her as Christ leads the church, and then see if in a week or 6 months or 6 years or six decades, at least as long as you haven't done it before, she starts to respond. And then we'll encourage you along that way. But I want to tell you, there's a reason that women sometimes can't be quiet. Their lives aren't tranquil because they're being led by a quarterback who doesn't know the offense. This is God's command in the context of restored relationship. Y'all get that? Now look, this is why it's so hard. I've thought really hard about how to say that this week. I really have. What's the problem? Why is this so difficult for some women to do? And I'll tell you exactly why. Let's look again at 1 Timothy chapter 2. He says there's a reason that there's a problem here. And here's how I'm going to say it. The reason, gals, you have a hard time following us is because you're a bunch of witches. All right? And listen, for the same reason you're a bunch of witches, you live with a bunch of sons of witches. All right? I told you, I spent all week thinking about how to say it, and you go, well, might want to spend 5 more minutes on that next time, Todd. But let me just explain to you biblically where I get that, okay? in Genesis chapter 3, and we're gonna finish 1 Timothy. In Genesis 3, God is explaining what's going on. What's going on is this. God said, hey, I'm Lord over creation. I'm going to make you my vice regents. Man, you lead woman as you walk with me. Man and woman together, you rule over the animal kingdom. You be stewards of the earth. Now, what happens in Genesis 3 is that the animal kingdom tells the women what to do, who tell the men to eat the apple so that they can know the difference between good and evil and tell God what is right and what is wrong. It is a direct inversion. Now, what God does is he goes, all right, children, gather up. I'm thrilled that you've done that because I gave you the freedom to. There's going to be great cost to that, but guess what? Animals, this world, and the prince of this world are not going to lead you. I am still sovereign and over male, and male, you're still over female, and female, you guys are still over the earth. But guess what? Now, there's enmity. There's tension between male and God. There is enmity between male and female. There is enmity between the world and you. And it's really going to be a problem, but that's just the way it is. And you guys are going to have to learn to deal with it. And grace will give you provision if you want it. But the order will be reestablished. My decree is fixed. But now you've got tension. Note to self. The word submit and be subject to never appear in Scripture prior to the fall. God never had to tell us to be subject to one another in love before the fall because we were, because we walked with God. We love like God loved. We live like God lived. We love being quarterbacks and wide receivers because quarterbacks were all about the wide receiver. Just like God was all about us. And so we were never told to be subject. Now look, what God says to the women in Genesis chapter 3, verse 16. To the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your pain in childbirth. Now just some genius men in the past have taken this and go, that's why women should not get epidurals. Because God said part of the judgment is going to hurt when they pushed. I love my wife. We were taking a Lamaze class. And they were kind of going around the room saying, now, how many of you women are going to try and go through natural childbirth? And several of the women kind of went, well, I'm going to do my best, and that's why we're here. You know, to learn to breathe and all that different stuff. My wife's like, look, I'm at month 6. You want to give it to me? Now I'll take it. All right? And there's a lot of people who are kind of like, oh, that's not good, because God said, you know, it's going to be pain to bring forth children, which is one, I guess, of a plausible interpretation. I love the fact, though, I would say, all right, guys, you want to say you shouldn't interrupt the pain of childbirth through epidurals, then I'm fine with that. Just put away your John Deere tractor as you bring forth fruit from the earth with toil and sweat from your brow. No more combines, all right? Just a hoe and you and the dirt clod. You cannot have a conviction of convenience here. What's going on is he's saying, look, now that there's enmity, you're going to bring forth sons of witches. That's what he's saying. And because you got sons of witches, they're going to rebel against you, and they're going to do stupid things, and they're going to break your heart just like you broke my heart. And so there's going to be pain now as you multiply out your tribe. See chapter 4. But watch this. And he says, and your desire will be for your husband. But he's still going to rule over you. What's this mean? I'll tell you what it means. It makes so much sense. Now, there's two different ways you can use the word desire. Okay, so what's our rule when we see a word like this? We've got to look at it and go, how's the author use it? This word shows up 3 times. The word quiet twice in the form that it's in 1 Timothy 2. And this word desire shows up 3 times. One time is in Song of Solomon chapter 7 verse 10. It is the bride celebrating the security of her marriage relationship with her husband. And she says, I am my beloved's. I love him, and his desire is for me. It's talking about a physical desire, an emotional desire, and this woman is saying, I absolutely love him, and he wants me. Now, let me just say this. If that's the curse, may my wife be smitten with a double, you know, portion of it. That's not the idea. It's one of the plausible definitions. But how about if we just go back to that author and see how he used that word? Genesis chapter 4. Then the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? In other words, Cain is now in the middle of a relationship that's gone south, and God's saying, careful, Cain. Why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will not your countenance be lifted up? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. It is an animal. It is a beast that wants to devour you like a wildebeest crossing the Serengeti through a little river with a bunch of crocodiles in it. Its desire is for you. But Cain, you must master it. Don't let it consume you. Don't be filled with anger. Be filled with the Spirit of God, which is still available to you by grace. Appeal to me. Let me humble you. Let me lead you to life. But Cain was consumed and brought destruction in the relationship. What this is saying in Genesis 3:16 is, woman, you've now got an idiot for a quarterback. You got a son of a witch. And it's going to be hard to follow him. And your desire is going to be to grab the pitchfork and storm the castle. But he's still going to be your man. He's still going to rule over you. And it's going to sometimes be really nasty. I would recommend that both of you humble yourself, ask for forgiveness, and restore your relationship with me. God says, that being done, men now can learn to love again the way that men were supposed to love. And women, you can respond the way you were supposed to respond. Do you remember? By the way, my friend Tom Nelson, I remember this from a long time ago. He asked his sweet wife, Teresa. He said, sweetie, what do you think that word means right there? Why do you think God said that your desire is going to be for your husband? What's that mean? Do you really, sweet dear wife, have a desire to rule over me? And she looked at me and she said, of course I do. I am fallen. I don't like authority any more than you like authority. I am a rebel at heart, and I always think I can do better. And I want to take my pitchfork and storm the castle. That's why the Bible tells me 3 times to submit. Because my heart is rebellious and I hate authority. But by the grace of God, remember what I said earlier? If I was a woman, I'd be a feminist unless I knew Jesus Christ. And I would fight. I'm going to just tell you, women, I want to ask you for forgiveness for gender stupidity. For however long your little earth wants to be, my 20,000 that I'll take credit for, we ask your forgiveness because we have not led you like Christ leads the church. And I marvel at your patience. But I will tell you here, at least for 9 years, we have tried to lead you with your best interests in mind. And we welcome you coming to us when there are things that we are not attentive to. We've got women that we go to all the time saying, how are we doing? How are we serving women? How are we celebrating women? Are we letting them teach other women in a way that's going to make them feel very valued? And I'm going to explain to you what women are to do. And I'm going to tell you how this ties back into Mama's Day. Okay? But gals, this is why the submit thing is so hard for you. Because A, guys don't lead the way Christ wants us to lead. And B, sometimes you don't let Christ let you play the role that you're supposed to play with all dignity and glory and nobility and beauty. It has nothing to do with your ability. It has everything to do with your authority and your assignment by God, who in his creative decree. And this is why, by the way, when you hear people try and explain away 1 Timothy 2:12, they say, well, that's our cultural thing. Let's just see how cultural 1 Timothy 2:12 is. I don't allow a man to teach or exercise authority over a man but to remain quiet. Why? First reason, verse 13. For it was Adam who was created first and then Eve. It's just the order. By the way, it says in the scripture in 1 Corinthians 11:3, it talks about how man is the head of every woman, but that Christ is the head of every man and God is the head of Christ. Now look, if you know your Trinitarianism, Jesus is God. He is not, though, the Father, and he is not the Spirit. The Son does nothing except it being according to the Father's will. The Spirit, it is said, wants to exalt the Son. The Father gives the Son the name that is above all names, so at the name of the Son, every knee will bow. There is distinct roles in the personage of God. The idea of roles is not a Western idea plugged into marriage. Marriage is an expression of multiplicity dwelling in unity. And so what God is saying to you is, look, it's because of creation. You've each got your roles. You're still both equal and dignified and honored, and there is no distinction between male or female in Christ. But that doesn't mean you don't have roles. There is equality, but not sameness. There is distinction in who we are in our expression of function. There is no distinction of deity between the Father and the Son. They are both God, but there is distinction. They are not the same. And the one is subject to the other, while the other exalts that one that is subject to him. And it's beautiful. And that's what God is saying marriage should be. And that's what he's talking about in the church. Women of Watermark, we want you to know, we want to honor you. We want to exalt you. We want this to be the place you've always dreamed about, where men are not doing anything but asking, how can we serve the women? And when we don't, we ask you in a way that's consistent with Scripture to admonish us in our unruliness, to help us in our weakness, to encourage us in our faint-heartedness, and to do that with great patience. Because we want you to live quiet and tranquil lives that you celebrate other-centered leadership over you. And in this community that's been redeemed, that's been restored out of the rebellion of the world and brought back into the Eden of relationship with God, it works. If we love and we lead the way Christ wants us to lead. This is why, gals, don't go marrying some Johnny come lately just because he carries a Bible. You meet him at Watermark. Make sure he knows what it means to follow God. Because the first place he's going to compromise is in his relationship with you, and you got hell to pay if your king's a tyrant and not a Christ follower. Now, back to mama. First reason, creation. That's not culture. That's just the way it always was and always will be. Second reason, it was Adam who was deceived, verse 14, but the woman being deceived fell into transgression. Just one verse in your Bible. By the way, Paul is under no illusion about who the real cause of sin was. Yes, Eve ate the apple first, but the man was supposed to lead. If you go back and read Genesis, it says that the woman took the apple and gave it to the man who was with her, who, by the way, did not teach her God's word well. If you go back and look, Paul gives one sentence to what the woman did in 1 Timothy. He commits an entire chapter to it in Romans chapter 5, talking about Adam's mess up. And you really want to trace sin back? Don't trace it to Eve, trace it to Adam, because the first sin was the failure of Adam to lead. But what he's saying is, look, women, I know it's going to be hard for you, okay, because you were deceived before that there's a better way, and so you're deceived now that you ought to storm the castle and try and be the man, but you're not the man. You guys aren't the same. You're equal in dignity, but you're not the same. You got different roles, and you cannot do what the quarterback's supposed to do, and you can fight for it all you want, but the fact is, both by God's sovereign ordination and creation and by God's sovereign decree, even in rebellion, that's the gig. Jesus is Jesus, the Father's the Father, the Spirit's the Spirit, they're all God, they love and work together in perfect harmony, and he says, work it out here in the church. This is the call, and we ought to lead that way. Now, how does this relate to mama? Okay, if a woman can't lead the church, what's she supposed to do to get some dignity? All right, answer, verse 15. But women will be preserved through the bearing of children. Okay, a couple of geniuses took this one, and they said, okay, that means that she's one day going to have the Messiah will come forth from her womb, so she'll be safe. The word preserved can be defined a number of different ways. It can mean like safe and sound, okay, like that pig's foot is safe and sound in that jar of formaldehyde. Or it can mean saved from ultimate judgment by a sovereign Lord. That's how it's used in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, where it says, if a man confesses with his lips that Jesus is Lord and believes in his heart that God raised him from the dead, he will be saved. The word is soter. When you study theology, you study soteriology. It is the doctrine of being saved from eternal judgment. So this could mean that women are saved eternally through childbirth, meaning that the Messiah will come from them. It could mean that they're saved from other things, safe and sound, if they stay out of the workplace and just at home, and they won't be corrupted by the workplace. What it really means here is the other definition of the word saved. It means given purpose, given dignity, made whole. Gals, you don't need to lead the church because I've got something better for you. You get to lead. You get to give birth to and shape to eternal humanity made in the image of God. Every now and then someone says, what's your wife do? And I don't ever just say, well, she's a mom, because I know that given the corruption of our world, people disrespect that. And so I like to say stuff like, well, she's a research assistant in the field of child development as it relates to human affairs, specifically in the areas of poverty, injustice, and global security. Wow. It's impressive. What my wife does is she raises up leaders that are going to make this world the world that it should be, that are concerned about poverty and injustice, help folks walk in security and goodness and grace and rightness. And what it's saying is, gals, you've got yourself a job. Let me tell you, there's an old Spanish proverb. It says that an ounce of mama is worth a ton of priest. And what that means is if mom does her job well and you listen to her, you're not going to call me and say, my life is screwed up. What do I do? Okay? If mom pours into that kid godliness and compassion and faith and sanctity and self-restraint and love, that is worth a ton of Sundays. Kyle did a great job a couple of weeks ago showing you all the balls that mama gets with Junior and the small amount of balls that the priest gets with Junior. So you want dignity? You be a mom. You make disciples. You take that child that for 18 years God puts in your little lap and you love them and you lead them. Women will be preserved through the bearing of children if they continue in faith, love, sanctity with self-restraint. In other words, let me say this to you. If you're a biological mama and you don't live with faith and love and sanctity and self-restraint, that is a bigger tragedy than somebody who is barren, because you were given a student that for 18 years sat at your feet. Can I tell you something about my sweet dear wife? I'm raising 6 kids, and I grabbed this a year ago. It was May 2008. She didn't even know I have this. And she sent an email to my son that I got a hold of. Listen to this. Dear Cooper, I just wanted to relay to you something I heard late yesterday. Some parents were commenting how they noticed you singing at the choir concert and were very encouraged. They also noticed the boys who did not sing. They said that one of your friends looked like he was in pain and bored to death. That is exactly why I had the conversation with you yesterday that I did about being a leader all the time. You lead even by faithfully serving. You lead by singing for your choir teacher who invested 8 weeks of her time with you. Even when it was something I knew you did not necessarily enjoy, that's why we talked. As a young man who says he wants to honor Christ, you did that in showing your teacher respect, honoring her time investment, and showing the watching parents, teachers, that you're not an apathetic and too cool kid to sing choir songs. People are watching you because of the stand you take for Christ, and it is not your job to perform for them. It is your job to let Christ live in you. Thank you, Coop, for choosing to do the right thing. I am proud of you, Mommy. Man. See, that right there, that is a ton of priest. And when you get a mom who does that, and who does that, and who does that, I don't need no Carly Fiorini. I don't need no Condoleezza Rice. I don't need no Hillary Clinton. That is dignity. That is honor. Now, I wanted to say this. I know there's some of you out there who do not have biological children. Well, let me just show you a picture. This gal up here is the reason many of you know Christ. How many folks here, like me, came to know Christ through Young Life? Bunch of us. How many of y'all ever heard a little ministry called Campus Crusade and had some impact in your life because of Campus Crusade? How many ever heard of a guy and were impacted some way spiritually by Billy Graham? You know who those boys are commonly called? They are called Mears men. This is Henrietta Mears. She died when she was 73. She never had kids, but she built into men. She specifically knew that the church needed men. They said she was predisposed to men in loving them and giving shape to them. I want to tell you something. She was courting a guy when she was 20 who wanted to marry her, and she said, I want to marry. I want to have kids. Her mama died when she was 20. The pastor of the church that they went to came and said, hey, the spiritual heritage that came from your grandmother to your mother is now going to you, and you need to fulfill the faithfulness that's been in your family. And she took one look at the bozo that she was courting, and she goes, that guy is not a quarterback. And so she broke it off with him, and there was never another guy that wooed her heart again. But she wooed the heart of guys to study God's word. Gary Stroop came up to me after the very first service and said, you know, the very first Christian book I ever read was by Henrietta Mears. Billy Graham says next to his wife and his mother, Henrietta Mears has had more impact on his life than anyone. Get you some of that. So you may not be a biological mama, okay? But you can still be a spiritual woman. And you can have great worth. How'd you like that? Show up and say, what do you got to say for yourself? Well, I led a Fortune 500 company. All right, next. Well, I poured my life into about 400 different men. The guy who founded Young Life, the guy who founded Campus Crusade for Christ, and the guy who spoke to more living humans than any other person in the context of history to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I did everything I could to pour into them, and 400 guys just like him, including Richard Halverson, the most famous chaplain in the history of the United States Senate. Well done, Henrietta. Come in. I want to tell you, gang, I'm not going to say I was an elder or pastor of Watermark, but I will say I hopefully made some disciples and the guys that I'm pouring into individually along the way. And women, you don't need to be distracted by what I do on Sundays or what I do the rest of the time. You be a mama. I want to tell you one more thing. Hey, have your career if you want. But if you don't save your best for home and raise disciples who in faith, love, dignity, and self-restraint follow Jesus, you have whiffed. And so you better save your best for home. Can I give my Father's Day message right now? Daddies, go make your money. Go buy your lake houses. Go have a couple of toys in your garage if you want. But if you don't save your best for home, if you don't make disciples in the home, you have failed, sir. And if you do not serve that woman of yours and exalt her in front of the kids, if you don't love their mother with dignity and honor and all the adjectives that I listed up there, you have failed, sir. So, I am in trouble because I've gone long. But if I'm going long, I'm going long for mama. That's what I'm going to do. Taking one from mama. All right? Do you see what this is all about? It's not so hard anymore, is it? Guys, let's lead in a way that women go, I've dreamed about guys like you. All I've ever wanted to do is a guy like you to be my leader. That's what he says should happen right here. And there's a video. We're not going to show this first video. It's a video that shows a couple that is giving themselves away to our Starting Blocks ministry. And it shows them getting up early. And it shows them loving. And it shows them serving. And it shows them transforming a family because they are the Henrietta Mears of Watermark. Do you know, those of you that are here on scholarship, that are here on a cruise ship, that are out about more things than being what 1 Timothy 2:15 says, you know we turned away 30 kids and the families that represent them first hour because we did not have enough workers to take in children? Do you know we're looking for folks to disciple high school students and college students? Henrietta, jump in. You can be a part of this. And so we need you. We'll show you that video in this service in one of the weeks ahead. But I want to tell you something. There is opportunity today to be preserved if you'll follow Christ. Now, this is a very important day, and so we started with country music, and we are ending with country music. And we asked for a number of folks to come in here and just send us different pictures. The children's ministry got word out to some moms, and we just put them together. You want to be somebody's hero, you lead them with faith and dignity and self-restraint and love, and you'll be their hero. Watch this.
Anybody from a burning building. She's never rocked Central Park to a half a million fans screaming out her name. She's never hit a shot to win the game. She's never left her footprints on the moon. She's never made a solo hot air balloon ride around the world. No, she's just but now her baby's moving on. And she already is. She's somebody's hero, a hero to her mother in a rocking chair. She runs a brush through her silver hair. The envy of the nursing home, she drives by every afternoon, feeds her mama with a spoon, and that smile lets her know. Her mother's smile lets her know. She's somebody's hero.
Ladies, ladies, ladies. Yeah. Let me just close by saying this. Ordinary, extraordinary kids do not come from ordinary homes. They come from homes where mama understands 1 Timothy 2:15, and she lives with love, with faith, with self-restraint, and with dignity because of her love for Jesus Christ. And men were setting them up to do just that, undistracted from the worries of the world, so that they can be a hero. They can be enshrined like other women in Hebrews 11, Hall of Faith. Ladies, your opportunity is firmly before you. Biological kids won't cut it. Loving them like 1 Timothy 2:15 will. If you don't have biological kids, we got a bunch of other peoples who need you, Henrietta. Come change the world with us. Have a great week of worship. We'll see you.